Good morning and welcome to the day two of our colloquium. And this will be our third and fourth and last session today. And we have distinguished speakers. Mr. Taha Yücel, who's the who's a member of the board of Rütük. And he's going to be talking about the development of broadcasting sector in Turkey in light of the new legal regulations. Now, this is a very important topic because the regulation in Turkey recently changed. So, I'm sure we will hear some very important observations as well. Then, my colleague Gökçen Karanfil will be. We will switch.
Yes.
Okay. Then. Mr. Volkan Öztürk, also from Rütük, he's the vice president in charge of technical services, as far as I can remember. He'll be talking about regulatory bodies in Middle Eastern countries. So this will be actually very enlightening in connection with the discussion we had yesterday. And then my colleague Gökçen will be talking about tapping the diaspora dynamics of transnational broadcasting from Turkey. So let's start with Mr. Taha Yücel, and the floor is yours.
Şuraya mı şey yapalım biraz? Evet, galiba daha iyi olacak. Açık herhalde değil mi telefon? Mikrofon. Okay, good morning everyone. I would like to give you some information about radio and television regulatory body Supreme Council and then give some information about Turkish broadcast industry. And we have renewed our law last year, so we will give some information about the benefits of new law. First of all, Radio and Television Supreme Council is the broadcast regulatory body of Turkey. We have two different regulators for approximately converged industry. So in some countries, you know, there is a converged regulator, but here in Turkey, we have one regulator for broadcast industry and one regulator for information and technologies industry. So we are working closely with this authority also. We have 9 members in Supreme Council. They are all elected by the parliament. So it's the difference of the regulatory organization of broadcasting sector. Other regulatory bodies are all selected by the government members, but only the broadcast sector regulator, Radio and Television Supreme Council, elected by the Turkish General Assembly. In 2005, Radio and Television Supreme Council has acquired constitutional status, but of course with the new constitution, maybe this will be changed, we'll see. The new law has been adopted in 2011, last year. So from 1994 to 2011, there were some problems, which I will mention later. But most of the problems are addressed by the new law, and we are trying to solve the problems. So Radio and Television Supreme Council is responsible for not only the content monitoring, because most of the time in Turkey, we are known as content monitoring body, but most of the time we give licenses, we do frequency planning and frequency allocations, we have some technical regulations, we have satellite regulator, satellite regulation, cable regulation, IPTV regulation, and etc. So we mostly deal with regulation, but sometimes, of course, we do content monitoring. In Turkey, we have around 80 million TV households, but of course, this is not the television television equipment number. Television equipment number is threefold of this number, approximately. So it's a very large audience. We have many broadcasting companies. Most of them are radio only, FM radio only, local broadcasting companies, but 300 of the broadcasters approximately broadcasting their programs from satellite and cable, and some of them are also terrestrial. We have two cable platforms, one for IPTV, one Turkcell normal cable operation. It's not penetrated much, but they are developing their digital transition. So approximately 500,000 of subscribers are now digital. Total number of subscribers is 1.2 million, but it is increasing slowly. We have two satellite platforms, pay TV platforms especially, with total 3.1 million subscribers, but it is also expanding very fast. Nowadays, you know, there is a playoff game, so set-top boxes are sold very easily. But of course, these are the numbers of pay TV subscribers, but of course, satellite penetration is very high in Turkey. Approximately 70% of the population receives programs from the satellite. So we have terrestrial also, but terrestrial is now losing audience to satellite and cable. But of course, with the digital terrestrial, there may be some opportunities for the audience to receive programs, HDTV programs and etc. in digital terrestrial. So we will see the results in next year. I mentioned the number of broadcasters. Of course, this is a very high number. This is the reason why we have so much broadcasters, because our broadcast ad sector is developing, expanding very fast. From 2009 to 2010, we have around 45% increase in ad revenues. And from 2010 to 2011, we have more than 20% increase in ad revenues of broadcasting sector, especially for television. So since this is the very fast developing sector, we have many broadcasters interested with the ad market and trying to get their shares. But most of the time, largest broadcasters get the most of the ad revenue. Small broadcasters are only survive. Of course, in 1994, our law first established, but of course, with the so much broadcasters which were available before the law, because Turkish private sector started as a de facto base without any law. And when we came to 1994, most of the broadcasters were available at that time, radio and television broadcasters in terrestrial environment. So it was very difficult for the government to regulate the existing broadcasters with a new law. And of course, there were some problems with government organizations. Frequency planning was not defined very well. So one company was responsible for frequency planning. Another one was responsible for approval. Another one was responsible for licensing and etc. So there were very confusing situation. And because of this reason, we couldn't allocate the frequencies until the new regulation. So most of the broadcasters has their towers only used for their purposes. So this is the reason when we look at to the some hills, broadcasting tower hills, we see many towers, and most of the time they are not very well established. But of course, with the new law, we address this problem also. And before the new law, we had five years of license period maximum. And this was a very short period, as you see. You cannot do any good business plan for 5 years. So this was also a problem for the broadcast industry. Also, government was taking total around 10% of their broadcasters' ad revenue. This is a huge number for the. This was a huge number for the broadcast industry. Also, there were some trust issues in rating measurements. It wasn't transparent enough, and it wasn't regulated enough. Also, there were no deadline for the sanctions. Of course, Supreme Council does the content monitoring, and we sometimes give the penalties. But there were no deadline for the penalties. So when you look at to the news programs and programs like that, broadcasters cannot change the programs. So if there is no deadline, then sometimes broadcasters have many high sanctions and problems. Also, there were some ad restrictions. There was a restriction in placement. We could only place advertisement 20 minutes separation in the last the law before, and political advertisement was not possible before the new law. Also, there were some restrictions for foreign capital. It was restricted by 25% for direct investment, and also it was restricted by a single company, and also IPO was not possible for the broadcasters. Content monitoring of the public broadcaster was also a problem before the new law, because we could give penalties to the private broadcasters, but public broadcasters, public broadcaster TRT, when they do the same mistake, it wasn't possible for them to get penalties. So this was also a problem before the new law. So we addressed all these issues. Also, of course, the European Union regulation was a good reference for us. So we tried our best to be very, how can I say, adapted to the European regulation. With the new law, broadcasters are defined as media content providers. So we had TV stations, radio stations separately before, but now we are looking to the broadcasters as media content providers, and one media content provider can broadcast one television, one radio, and one video on demand service. So it is an umbrella organization, and they are regulated as media content providers. Also, we have platform operators and infrastructure operators for satellite cable and IPTV business. These platform and infrastructure operators were not regulated in the past, but now with the new law, we have some regulation, and we give operation permit for these operators. And also, we defined multiplex operators and transmitter and tower contract operator for the terrestrial environment. Also, they will get their permission from Supreme Council for operation. Of course, if they are operated for telecom industry also, they will get their telecom operation permit from telecom regulator. But if they do broadcast business, then we also give the broadcast permit. With the new law, if you look at to the economical aspect, we have now less restrictions for the broadcaster shareholder companies. In the past, there were very high restrictions, especially most of the commercial companies could not be the shareholders of the broadcasting companies in the past. But now we have only restrictions for the stock market organizations, because we don't want broadcasters to speculate in the stock market. So there are some restrictions for the stock market companies, but other the companies can be shareholder of the broadcasting organizations. We have again direct foreign capital share limit, but it is increased to 50%, and it is now possible for a foreign investor directly invest in two companies. It was in the past one, but now it's possible to invest in two companies directly. But if it is indirect, then there are less restrictions, but we have some restrictions for the management of the company. General manager must be Turkish citizen if there is an indirect foreign investment. Majority of the board must be Turkish citizens, but other than there is no share limit if it is indirect foreign capital, for foreign capital. Shares of the media service provider companies can be traded now in the stock market, because in the past the shares of the media service providers must be written to the names, so it was preventing media companies to issue their stocks. But now it is possible, because we don't want the media companies to write shares in the name if it is open to the market. Control of monopolization is also regulated by the new law. We have two regulations, one for sector income. If one investor's shares, if one is someone investing broadcasting companies, then the broadcasting companies sectoral income, broadcast companies income are totaled, and it is also divided by the sectoral income. It must be at most 30%. So if it exceeds 30%, then we don't give any penalty to the broadcasters, but we talk to investors, and investors should sell some of the investments from some companies. But it's not a very important problem for Turkey. Most of the companies do not exceed this limit. And also there is another control for monopolization. Number of broadcaster, terrestrial broadcaster stations must be at most four for the direct investment or indirect investment. If someone investing more than four companies for terrestrial area, then also we don't let them to do this kind of operation. Also, gross ad revenue government share has been reduced from 10% to 3%. We only take 3% of their revenues, but of course, when we look at to the expansion of broadcast ad industry, maybe in the future it will be reduced to 1% in the future. License period has been extended from 5 years to 10 years. Political advertisement and product placement have been regulated. It's a very good opportunity for the broadcasters, especially when we look at the new media. Most of the time now people can pass the advertisement or can store and watch their programs at their convenient time. So it affects the ad market heavily. So product placement will address this issue, and now we have, of course, a regulated product placement in the television series, television programs, and most of the time people get very good revenue from this product placement. Also, we have less restrictions for ad placement. 20% rule is also applied, but 20 minutes separation has been cancelled. So within 1 hour, one broadcaster can broadcast 12 minutes of at space total, but they can also use this 12 minutes for 6 times. The new, when you look at to the new media law, we have also many technological aspects. First of all, we have now a very well-defined, very clear timetable for digital transition. It is defined by the law. We are now in the phase of finishing our frequency planning in digital television area. So we will publish our digital frequency plan for terrestrial broadcasting, and we will have a tender, we hope, at the end of this year, and we will allocate the frequencies to the broadcasters, and most of the broadcasters will be only digital. Some of them, and only small amount of them, will be analog and digital for 2 years, and after 2 years, we will switch off analog frequencies. So we have a net analog switch off date. It is March 2015. So we hope to be with this agenda. Analog TV, and also we have multiplex platform and cable and satellite broadcast operators are defined, as I mentioned before. With the new law, we are now mostly compliant with the European Union Audiovisual Media Services Directive. Freedom of expression and information is ensured, and it is the first, it is very well defined in the first item, and also the first duty of radio and television Supreme Council is to ensure the freedom of expression and information. Self-regulation and certification of broadcasters also is regulated by the new law. There are audience representatives in the broadcasting companies, and they are responsible for the broadcasters broadcasters how can I say operation in of course content issues. Also we have a rule limiting volume level of commercials. We don't have now FX and music in the news. It was a huge problem in the past. Regulation of the public broadcasters is now possible, and also we give penalties to the public broadcaster also. Legal framework for protective symbol system is a very important system for protecting children. We started this project without a law, but sometimes broadcasters use wrong symbols, used wrong symbols in the past. Now it is regulated by the new law, and it is now mostly going very well. And this is also a summary of roles and responsibilities of organizations. We have, of course, regulatory body. For the terrestrial tender, we will give multiplex capacities to broadcasters. Broadcaster will use multiplex operator to send their programs to the tower operator. There will be a single tower operator, and it is built by the broadcasters, terrestrial broadcasters. And this tower operator is responsible for building all the tower stations, towers, and it will be a company give service to the broadcasters in the future. And this is the roles and responsibilities. We have the government regulatory bodies, Radio and Television Supreme Council, and also Information and Communication Regulatory Body. We have broadcasters. They are responsible for the antenna operation. And also, of course, this antenna company can also do the multiplex business if needed. And also, we are now regulating the set-top box industry with the digital terrestrial. Most of the people will need set-top boxes for receive programs. So we are now a draft book for the standards of the set-top boxes for terrestrial. And we are now taking views of industry. And after we finalize the document, then we will also build a test and approval center for set-top boxes. And we will inform the people about the Turkish digital terrestrial standard. And most of the television sets, new television sets, will have this standard. And also set-top boxes will be regulated. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, too. And the details of the regulation, the law, the legislation, and also the technical aspects, the technical structure of the media system is actually very important. It's how the media operating on that actually is shaped. These things define how the media operates in the country. So I'm sure there will be lots of questions about this in the discussion section now. We will be hearing from Mr. Öztürk.
Evet, herkese merhabalar. Ben iki gündür bu üniversiteyi gördükçe geçmişe dönüp tekrar öğrenci olabilir miyiz diye düşünüyorum. Çok güzel imkanlar sunulmuş. Çok şık bir üniversite. Burada olmaktan ben çok memnun olduğumu söylemek istiyorum. Orta Doğu ülkelerindeki RTÜK benzeri kuruluşların durumlarını ben bir miktar anlatmaya çalışacağım. Hamit Bey'in bulunduğu yerde onun konusunu anlatıyoruz belki ama tamamen uzmanlık gerektiren bir konu olmakla birlikte bu konuyu ben izah etmeye çalışacağım. First of all, it gives me a great pleasure to have the opportunity to say a few words in this distinguished meeting. As you well know, mass communication, telecommunication, and information technologies have been converging since the beginning of widespread deployment of digital technologies. This process has triggered the transformation of transnational media, radio and television, and has given rise to the emergence of the services which is called new media. For you, for academicians, the definition of new media refers to all those means of communication, representation, and knowledge in which we find the digitization of the signal and its content that possesses dimensions of multimediality and interactivity, means feedback. Indeed, this type of conceptualization reasonably describes and encompasses all the intertwining new media arising from digital migration, such as digital television, online newspapers, mobile phones, and the newborn digital media, such as the interpersonal and the mass communication fields on the internet, like email, search engine, and social media, and the computer game consoles like PlayStation. From regulatory perspective, without taking into consideration whether it is called traditional or new media, the term media refers to those responsible for the periodic creation of information and content and its dissemination over which there is editorial responsibility. Irrespective of the means and technology used for delivery, which are intended for reception by and which could have a clear impact on a significant proportion of the general public. This could, inter alia, include print media, newspapers, periodicals, and media disseminated over electronic communication networks, such as broadcast media, radio, television, and other linear audiovisual media services, online news services such as online editions of newspaper and newsletters, and non-linear audiovisual media services such as on-demand television or on-demand video. As we all know, since their emergence as means of mass communication, media have been the most important tool for freedom of expression in the public sphere, enabling people to exercise their right to seek and receive information. Today, media animate and provide a space for public debate. They offer comment and opinion as part of political dialogue, contribute to setting the political agenda and the shaping the public opinion, and often seek to promote certain values. Media facilitate the synchronicity of public and political affairs and private or business-related matters, thereby increasing transparency and accountability. Moreover, media provide education, entertainment, cultural and artistic expression. They also play an important part in the economy, create jobs, and generate income for each and every nation. This means a total benefit, total profit for any nation. To understand the importance of regulation of the media, we should firstly recognize the above stated crucial role that media play in the society. As it is mentioned, the role of the media goes much further than simply providing information about current events and issues. Media also play a formative role in society. That is, they are largely responsible for forming the concepts, belief systems, and even languages, visual and symbolic as well as verbal, which citizens use to make sense of and to interpret the world in which they live. In the contemporary world, the rationale for intervention to media based on a certain number of public interests, objectives, which should be preserved in the society. These concerns can be listed as pluralism, diversity, fairness, and impartiality, social responsibility, maintenance of high quality programming, and of cultural and linguistic identity, coverage of important events, protection against abuse of market power, strengthening national and regional industries, protection of consumers, and maintenance of standards in matter of violence, sex, taste, and decency. Currently, several types of authorities are in charge of supervising the implementation of broadcasting legislation in the world. Broadcasting regulation usually encompasses the power to license broadcasters, to monitor whether broadcasters are fulfilling their legal obligations, and to impose sanctions if they fail to carry out those obligations. To those traditional functions of the organizing and coordinating the broadcasting landscape can be added. Broadcasting regulatory may be exercised by governmental administrative authorities or by courts, for example, for issues regarding the protection of fundamental rights. Moreover, in certain parts of the world, broadcasting sector may be subject to different forms of self-regulation. However, the most common organization form in the world is that of the independent regulatory authority, which is characterized by the fact that it is not part of the actual structure of governmental administration, and that it has apparatus which does not serve an other body and its disposal. Generally, the rise of independent regulatory authorities has coincided with the decline of public service monopolies in the 80s. In the Middle East, where the private broadcasting has started to appear in the 90s, broadcasting sectors are regulated and supervised by independent regulators or other institutions need to ministries, such as Minister of Information, Ministry of Culture. In 17 Middle East countries, Israel, Qatar, Lebanon, Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus, Republic of Cyprus, Jordan, Iraq, and United Arab Emirates have established their independent broadcasting regulatory authorities. Other countries in the region, which are Bahrain, Egypt, Iran, Kuwait, Oman, Palestine, Saudi Arabia, Syria, and Yemen, don't have independent broadcasting regulatory authorities yet. They regulate the sector through the related ministries. Except from Bahrain, Iran, Oman, Saudi Arabia, Syria, and Yemen, Middle East countries have public and private broadcasters together in their national media sectors. On the other hand, all over the Middle East, every country can receive regional and international broadcasts via satellite networks and internet. Egypt, with her private satellite channels, and a large number of Arabic satellite channels available via subscription. And Qatar, with her international channel, Al Jazeera, have special place in the region in terms of broadcasting. When we take into consideration the neighboring Islamic region, the countries Malaysia, Indonesia, and Pakistan have also mentioning regarding their relatively developed broadcasting sectors and regulations. As might be expected, revising the organizational structure of the regulatory authorities according to the recent technological development is crucial for the sustainable progress of the sector. In line with the recent technological developments, Malaysia and Pakistan have converge their regulatory authorities, which are Malaysian Communication and Multimedia Commission and Pakistan Electronic Media Regulatory Authority, respectively, to be able to answer the needs of the sector. Furthermore, these countries will, with their improved broadcasting sectors and regulatory serving to multi-ethnic, multilingual and multicultural societies have a special place in terms of ensuring diversity, plurality, and freedom of expression and information. Both the experience of Islamic countries and the experience gained worldwide indicate that the independent regulatory authorities, whether they are converged or not, paved the way for adoption of the recent technological developments in the media sector. But more importantly, independent regulatory authorities, as they are independent from the actual structure of governmental administration, would interruptedly protect and promote the fundamental human rights and public interest, which could be summarized as follows: ensuring plurality of ownership, ensuring fair and effective competition, ensuring diversity of content, protecting individual rights to privacy, free speech, etc., protecting intellectual property rights, maximizing individual choice and access to information, and very importantly, ensuring a high level of protection of minors and human dignity. In this context, it will be necessary to mention about IBRAF, like iPhone, the OIC, Organization of Islamic Cooperation Initiative, which aims at establishing dialogue and cooperation among existing broadcasting regulatory authorities and contribute to the establishment of new broadcasting regulatory bodies in OEC member states, which don't have any so far. Primary functions and aims of these platforms are as follows: to promote dialogue between broadcasting regulatory authorities, to promote cooperation among broadcasting regulatory authorities, to provide a forum for exchange of information, views and experience about common topics of broadcasting, to provide a forum for discussion to problem regarding broadcasting, and to provide a forum for discussion in a very variety of audiovisual matters, such as cultural diversity, cultural heritage, etc. Before I end my speech, I would like to wish success to IBRAF and this kind of initiatives working for the development of regulatory systems which will try to ensure fundamental human rights, public interests, and relatedly peace and stability in the Middle East. I would like to conclude thanking you very much for your attention and hope you have had fruitful discussion over the past 2 days. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, my colleague, my dear colleague, Gökşen Karanfil.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, I'm going to talk about the title of my paper is Tapping the Diaspora. Transnational dynamics from Turkey, dynamics of transnational broadcasting from Turkey. So what I'm basically going to try and do is talk about the importance of transnational broadcasting in terms of mobilizing the diaspora or the members of the diaspora and migrant communities, mobile populations, on two levels. On the first level, for the state benefits or the state incentives, and on the second level, on a capitalistic, more neoliberal capitalistic perspective. So, let me begin. Although political mobilizations among migrant populations are not completely new phenomena, the importance of diasporas in international and national politics has significantly increased over the past few decades. Many scholars point to the emergence of a new form of politics that transcend and do not depend on the territorial boundaries of the state. So in the contemporary global order, where the scale of mobile populations that move across boundaries has peaked, and where the dissemination of ideas, finances, and people have become unrestrained by geographic boundaries, there are a variety of ways, as Stephen Vertovec puts it, in which internationally dispersed social groups mobilize and undertake a range of electoral and non-electoral political activities. For example, lobbying in host countries to influence homeland politics, engaging in mass protests about homeland-related issues, sending remittances and mass capitals to the homeland, supporting or assailing terrorism, taking ideas on domestic violent conflicts, are but some examples of such political activities exercised by diasporas around the world. And as a consequence of these politically and economically influential manifestations of diasporic groups, these internationally dispersed populations have now become highly significant for many countries that have sizable diasporas. Again, as Vertovec notes, I quote, many countries such as Israel and Armenia regard their diasporas as strategically vital political assets, while others, such as India, the Philippines, and other migrant-sending countries, have been recognizing the massive contributions their diaspora make through remittances. I end quote. Now, regardless to say, within this context, the Turkish diaspora also has an increasing significance for Turkey in relation to politically, economically, and culturally charged issues, such as the Turkish-Kurdish ethnic conflict, the proliferating brain drain, politicization of Islam, the processes towards EU membership, accumulation of an Islamic capital, and whatnot. So we can count many of these processes in which the Turkish diaspora becomes a very important actor in influencing these processes. And as Mr. Öztürk has mentioned a minute ago, media, as we all know, has a very important potential in the ways in which media is being put to use, has a very important potential in creating public debate or public opinion, so on and so forth. So, in fact, the Turkish diaspora has demonstrated on many occasions its influence over both domestic and international affairs of the Turkish nation state. Turkey's economy and politics have been directly impacted, for example, by the substantial financial aid which flowed from the Turkish diaspora following the 1999 earthquake. The absence or contributions of expatriate votes that helped shape the 2002 and 2007 national election results, and the proliferation of an Islamic material and intellectual capital among the diaspora are some examples to this. Furthermore, Turkey has been significantly affected, both domestically and in the international arena of politics, by financial and political activisms of other diasporic groups and organizations in addition to the Turkish diaspora, such as the Kurdish and Armenian diasporas, for example. The mass demonstrations that took place among Kurds around the world following the capture of Kurdish leader Abdullah Öcalan in 1999, the lobbying of the Armenian-American diaspora in the USA for the relatively recent acceptance of the Armenian genocide claims in the Committee on Foreign Affairs of the U.S. House of Representatives in 2007, or the struggles of the leaders of the stateless Kurdish diaspora towards the establishment of a Kurdish state constitute such examples. Now, in this sense, the Turkish state has always felt that informing and mobilizing its national diaspora, national in quotes, had become much more significant in terms of establishing a counterforce from afar against the financial and political activisms of other diasporic groups, which it perceived as, again in quotes, threats to its solidarity. In light of all these developments, like many other countries, Turkey as a state has felt the pressing need to reach its hand to its expatriates through its consulates, to its embassies, religious representatives, political party representatives, and various other cultural organizations. Furthermore, the intellectual, financial, political, and ideological resources of the diaspora have also been recognized and mobilized by various other circles in Turkey as well. Perhaps considering the struggles Turkey is giving in the international arena of politics today, coupled with the domestic turbulence it's experiencing, the prominence of the Turkish expatriate and Turkey's need to tap into its diasporic resources have become even more significant. Now, while these developments clearly articulate the significance of diaspora for the state, to try and understand the importance of these diasporic groups, be it economically, politically, or culturally, in relation to the nation-state per se, would be highly problematic, I think. Because particularly since the last few decades of the 20th century, with the advent in the intensification of globalization and capitalism, mobile populations around the world have also become extremely valuable markets for both national and transnational capital. In this sense, diasporic groups, in addition to being approached by their states of origin for their political incentives, have also become objects of interest for profit-seeking parties. Particularly, the national capital from the homeland of these diasporic groups is looking for ways to reach these diasporic markets. Today, a plethora of commercially owned and run television channels have taken the plunge and are broadcasting transnationally to forge a share for themselves from the market of transnational ethnic minorities. Needless to say, the case is exactly the same in relation to these developments. The case is the same in Turkey as well. Now, the relatively with the recent increase in the mobility of populations, we now have this critical mass living outside the borders of the nation state, but who may actually, or who have proven over and over again how valuable they may be if they are mobilized, you know, activated, tapped into. And the relatively recent developments in the information and communication technologies offer an unprecedented potential for such endeavors, for tapping into these resources of both the nation states and the profit-seeking capitalist entrepreneurs. The current transnational media networks are at the heart of diasporic communications, which establish connections both among dispersed populations and between diasporas and homelands that are direct, simultaneous, and synchronized and effective. These new developments have now started to render the conventional national media paradigm inapplicable to the contemporary media order around the world. As Apadrai reminds us, as electronic media, quote, increasingly link producers and audiences across national boundaries, and as these audiences themselves start new conversations between those who move and those who stay, we find a growing number of diasporic public spheres. Now, of course, these public spheres are not those identified by Habermas, in that they transcend the national imagery, all the while fostering an unprecedented kind of diasporic consciousness. And we argue today that it is this diasporic consciousness and these diasporic public spheres that become a potential excursion of force when politically and economically activated. Building on these arguments, here I will elaborate on the ways in which Turkish transnational media can be looked at as one of the key apparatuses for mobilizing diasporas within the process of globalization. How successful transnational broadcasting from Turkey is in this sense, or is not. Now, the developments during the last few decades in ICTs are becoming the most influential factors in positioning diasporas as highly prominent actors in both national and international politics, as I've just suggested. Unsurprisingly, the realization of these new developments has motivated many local, regional, and national broadcasting entrepreneurs to engage in transnational communications. As Kevin Robbins has noted, it is not predominantly the gigantic Western media conglomerates that are privileged with transborder reach anymore. And this is very important, I think. While the Western-centered media conglomerates are becoming more powerful, we can't deny this, but in addition to the smaller media organizations that are broadcasting transnationally, from their non-Western standpoints have also grown in numbers, as Chalabi reminds us. Multi-Choice in South Africa, for example, Z Network in India, and TRT in Turkey are some such examples. As again, Can Chalabi notes, I quote, transnational TV channels have multiplied and grown in diversity over the past 10 years to include some of the most innovative and influential channels of our times. Many of them are at the heart of the transformation of regional media cultures, most noticeably in the Middle East, South Asia, and even Africa, but also in Europe. Now, recognizing the potentials of these new channels, first TRT in 1999, followed by other ideologically oriented and commercially motivated Turkish television channels in mid-1990s, have stepped into the arena of transnational broadcasting via satellite dishes to seek their audiences afar. Since 1990s, there have been various television channels that have broadcasted transnationally from Turkey with some sort or another transnational content. Some of the influential ones, I can't count all of them, and some of them have changed over the time, but some of the influential ones have been Eurode, ATV Avrupa, Showtürk, Eurostar, TRT INT, which is closed now, TRT Türk, TRT Avaz, Samanyolu TV Avrupa, Kanal 7 INT, TGRT INT, and etc. And there are a number of others as well. Now, in addition to these channels, the Turkish expatriate in most European countries also has access to most of the national Turkish channels now, due to this space-related technologies, satellite broadcasts. Turkish channels that are on satellite dishes such as NTV, Lig TV, Power Türk, Türkmax, and various other stations that are included in the DigiTürk and DMAX satellite package. So the expatriate, the Turkish diaspora now, can actually view both channels' broadcasts supposedly geared towards them, and also broadcasts that are just for the Turkish nation. But Ayşe Çağlar notes that in order to make sense of the developments the Turkish media environment is going through, it becomes crucial to evaluate these processes within the context of cross-border ethnic media in the world. As Karim Karim reminds us, the most important and the earliest examples of cross-border ethnic media come from the Mexican and Brazilian Televisa and TV Globo networks respectively, the former aiming the Spanish-speaking populations in Latin America and the latter the Portuguese-speaking communities scattered around the world. Again, as Charlar notes, I quote, the international expansion of Televisa to capture the Spanish-speaking populations of USA started as early as mid-50s. It created a network through the US to distribute programs and sell advertising to them, end quote. Now, these developments within the South American media context induce a tremendous change in the global media order. Such rapid developments in new media technologies opened up unprecedented avenues for the production and distribution of new forms of transnational media. As the audiences become more segmented, broadcasters that target ethnic communities across national borders are also growing in numbers. Therefore, the share of ethnic transnational media in global communication flows is steadily growing. So on the one hand, you have segmentation of viewers, diasporic viewers, and as a response to this, you have the increasing number of broadcasters who are specifically targeting these segmented viewers. Now, it is now possible to view, for example, pro-Islamic broadcasts or channels such as Roj TV, also, although its license has been banned recently, broadcasting in Kurdish, ZTV broadcasting across Asia in Hindi, or NBC targeting Arabic speakers in Europe, broadcasts mainly targeting males, like Lig TV, for example, music channels targeting mainly young viewers. Thus, today there's access to media which conceives itself in much more local references than the conventional, the traditional national broadcasts. Hence, today a new media order is rapidly forming that renders geographic, national, cultural, ethnic, and financial borders obsolete, all the while contributing to the formation of unprecedented transnational hybrid cultural formations. This model of contemporary global media, that is, a media that seeks its audiences transnationally, is manifested by media flows that transcend borders of all kind, spanning the world but being consumed in, for example, in Chinese, Spanish, Arabic, or Turkish among communities that speak these languages wherever they may be. So what's happening in Turkey? or what has happened, what has been happening in Turkey in relation to all these developments in the new information and communication technologies. There has been a tremendous and rapid change going on in Turkish broadcasting scene since 1990s in relation to transnational broadcasts, and I guess we can suggest that the June of 2008, as far as I know, is another breaking point because a new law has passed regarding again international broadcasts from Turkey. But up until that time, if you look at what has happened in a nutshell, in 1990, TRT launched its first transnational channel, TRT INT. Initially, TRT INT started broadcasting to Turkish migrants living in Western European countries as a politically and ideologically state-oriented project. 2 years later, in 1992, the second transnational channel of the Turkish Republic Broadcasting Service was launched. Turkish Public Broadcasting Service was launched. With the name of TRT Avrasya, the second transnational enterprise of TRT was planned as a channel that would target the Turkic republics, which emerged with the collapse of the Soviet Union, such as Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, and others. In 2002, TRT Avrasya changed its name to TRT Türk TV, and in 2009, TRT INT ended its broadcasts. Again in 2009, TRT Türk delivered all its frequencies to this newly opened TRT Avaz, and TRT Türk continued broadcasting as a news and culture channel. Of course, this is just on the level of public service broadcasting. In 1999, then TRT broadened its reach to Turkish migrants in USA, Australia, and New Zealand as well. Now, when we look at these developments of the last decade and a half, it is now possible to claim, in the words of Aksoy and Robbins, that I quote, TRT as the agent, effectively, of the Turkish state, has been involved in a systematic strategy of cultural transnationalization. It is a strategy that has aspired to connect together the imagined community of Turks at a global level. And now but of course, following TRT's plunge into transnational broadcasting, many commercial channels started going through the same scene as well. We have Euroday, for example, ATV, Europa, as I've suggested. And the emergence of commercial channels in the 1990s loosened the TRT monopoly and appeal amongst most of the transnational viewers. So while TRT and TRT Avrasya were heavily consumed by migrants living outside of Turkey, the members of the Turkish diaspora, after commercial channels started broadcasting, similar to the case within the national borders of Turkey, the diasporic population started preferring viewing commercial channels. The first commercial channel to explicitly target Turkish migrants in Europe was the expansion of domestic show TV. So domestic show TV as Euroshow. Later it turned into Showtürk in 1995. Subsequently, Euroday and ATV Avrupa started broadcasting in Europe in 1999 and 1997 respectively. Sorry, 1996 and 1997. These channels pursued economic profit and their broadcasts consisted of selections from the schedules of their original counterparts that were broadcasting nationally. ATV Avrupa is an expansion of ATV, Showtürk is an expansion of Show TV, and Euroday is an expansion of Kanal D. With the advent of satellite distribution along with TRT in programs in 1999, Turkish migrants in USA and in 2002 Turkish diaspora in Australia and New Zealand started receiving these transnational commercial channels from Turkey as well. Now, when we look at all these channels, I would argue that the channels that are the most geared, or that were the most geared to the needs and wants of the Turkish diaspora, were transnational enterprises of TRT, in fact, TRT INT and TRT Türk. Because most of the commercial channels, they had no interest whatsoever about what the migrant might be interested in. I mean, all they would do would be just broadcast their own content, own national educational content to the transnational viewer. In fact, I had an interview a year or 2 years back with the general director of Canal D, and I asked this person, you know, you have this special channel that is broadcasting mainly to Turks living in Europe, and what's your policy in terms of creating programs? And the answer he gave me was something like, well, you know, they don't really need anything special because we just you know, broadcast our sitcoms here, we just broadcast our quiz shows here, and they like that. Besides, we make a joke here and they laugh, you know, 15 seconds later, so they're not all that like us anyway. So when someone at the very top of a channel that is responsible for transnational broadcasting says something like this, I think we have to, you know, sit and reconsider what's happening now. So in this context, I think again TRT's transnational enterprises have been the channels that are most geared to needs and wants of the Turkish diaspora. But I say this with reservation. Important portions of these channels' broadcast segments are directly targeted to the diasporic viewer. Nevertheless, even these channels broadcast from within a national broadcasting logic, I think. When we consider the information in the broadcasting plan of TRT of 2009, it becomes even more clear, I think. In this plan, the broadcasting goals of the station, the transnational international broadcasting goals of TRT in 2009, I think, was to strengthen the ties between our citizens living overseas and Turkey and Turkish culture, to represent all aspects of Turkey and Turkish nationals, to raise their educational and cultural levels, to help Turkish nationals around the world preserve their language, religion, morals, unity and solidarity, to maintain their connections with the Turkish Republic by strengthening their spirits and showing how their various problems can be resolved, so on and so forth. Now, it is clear from these goals that TRT INT, as this agent of the state, was concerned directly with what it had seen as the cultural well-being of its viewers. But the problem I should like to point out here is that this cultural well-being is actually an imagined one. That is, the broadcasting goals of the station are exclusively geared towards emphasizing a Turkish agenda and taking the national context of Turkey as the main reference point. Actually, this clearly reflects the broadcasting tradition of TRT in its national counterpart, TRT as well. As we all talk about this, TRT has many times been claimed or accused of being a channel that imagines its nation and broadcasts to it and cannot really create that, or had not been able to create that link, the organic link between the nation and the broadcasters. So I see more or less the same issue in the transnational counterparts of TRT as well. The content of the majority of these television stations accessible to the Turkish diaspora is, as I've said, either exactly or more or less the same as their national counterparts. How am I doing? This, of course, means that most of these channels are neither relevant to the migratory conditions of the members of the Turkish diaspora, nor to the daily lives of these diasporic subjects in their host countries. Having said this, we do need to acknowledge here that they are in Turkish, they are from Turkey, and these are two aspects of the broadcast that in themselves are significant for the diasporic populations. Perhaps what also needs to be mentioned is that the content of these commercial channels, the commercial channels that are broadcasting transnationally, in general is identical to almost any global media. It appears possible to view exactly the same programs in exactly the same formats in any other national or global television channel. For example, The Wheel of Fortune or sitcoms. So these are generic global programs, particularly programs broadcasted by Eurode or the programs that are broadcast by ATV Avrupa and Samanyolu TV Avrupa. This automatically raises the question, how Turkish are these Turkish media? When we put aside the fact that these television channels broadcast in Turkish, that the news items are mostly related to domestic news about Turkey and that they broadcast from Turkey. What else is Turkish about them, really? And finally, the content of the transnational channels being exclusively consumed by the Turkish diaspora also needs to be considered in the light of the fragmentation of the Turkish migrant populations around the world. Although one might be tempted to think that all Turks around the world live similar lives in their host countries, this is not actually true. As I have suggested earlier, the availability of these channels does not merely raise the issue of choosing Turkish in place of hostland media for the Turkish migrant viewer. Perhaps more importantly, the availability of these diverse media from homeland, from Turkey, also offers them the option to choose from among these Turkish channels, and hence also offers a diverse range ways of identifying themselves with Turkishness. So there are different ways of being Turkish, and different Turkish media do this or offer this to migrants, Turkish migrants, who are really not homogeneous. In a relatively recent study conducted by Rütük in 2007, there are currently approximately 600 households in Germany that have access to satellite televisions broadcasting from Turkey. This is a study which was conducted through a questionnaire on 5,000 participants, researching the television consumption patterns of Turkish migrants living in, Germany. This was a research conducted in 2007 by Rütük. According to this same research, it is indicated that 66.3% of Turkish migrants in this country, in Germany, prefer to watch Turkish television. This translates to one out of every three Turkish migrants in Germany consuming Turkish satellite television more than any other form of media. These findings alone can give us an insight concerning the potential of this consumer market or the dispersed viewers, whichever way one wishes to see it. One of the major findings of this research conducted by Rütük was that while the Turkish television stations that broadcast transnationally to Germany find themselves a viewer market in Germany, where they are literally unchallenged, most of the Turkish-speaking viewers in this country believe that these channels were not successful in filling this void, hence taking advantage of this uncharted territory. So this research by Rütük has shown that while they are being consumed heavily, the Turkish channels, the consumers are not actually satisfied. So they're mainly being consumed because they are unchallenged, in a sense. In other words, the members of the Turkish diaspora located in Germany, while preferred to consume Turkish transnational television, in reality were not satisfied. As a major reason for this dissatisfaction, the non-relevant content of these broadcasts were shown. And finally, I'd like to conclude by saying, while the accessibility of transnational media from Turkey has changed the lives of these viewers and their connections with the homeland in unprecedented ways, it needs to be stressed here that this has been the case not mainly because these satellite these televisions have broadcasted highly relevant content to the migrant conditions, but more so simply because these media are from Turkey and in Turkish. The above-mentioned Rütük report indicates that 6 out of every 10 Turkish migrants in Germany is concerned that Turkish televisions do not cater to their needs and do not reflect on the developments and events that are related directly to them and to their migratory experiences. What needs to be firmly stated here is that unless these stations like TRT, like the previous TRT, like Eurodea, ATV, Avrupa, so on and so forth, unless these stations that broadcast transnationally to migrant viewers reconsider their broadcasting policies and regear them to the real needs of these diasporic viewers, they may soon have to leave this market, where they are currently unchallenged, but to other entrepreneurs who may find better ways to respond to the needs of the Turkish migrant viewers. So today they may be unchallenged, and hence they may be easily consumed, but as soon as someone else decides to fill this gap in a more effective way, they may actually start losing audiences. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all very much, and thank you for this very interesting analysis of Turkish transnational television. Now we'll be heading to the discussion, and yes, let's start there.
Question for Gökçen. Gökçen, thank you for this very interesting and very informative talk. One of the things that I've always been curious about, I'm not very familiar with the field of migrant studies that you've been involved in. But one of the things that's very much discussed, as far as I know, is this phenomenon of so-called long-distance nationalism. It seems that with the process of globalization, there's also a new kind of space of competition among nation states, and especially for those nations who have large communities of migrants in Europe and the United States and elsewhere, this seems to be a field of manipulation or whatever. I don't exactly know what the particular stakes are, but one can imagine that there nation states would be interested in this kind of activities. So there is also, first of all, the aspect that comes from the nation state, but also these communities themselves, among them, there are, it seems again, certain nationalistic tendencies, a kind of nationalistic kind of response that is given to often the oppressive environment in which they find themselves, a racist, oppressive, exclusionary environments. I mean, one example of this would be, for instance, again, I don't know which side one must put this, but again, a movement that comes from below, of course, MHP and their leader, Turkish National Movement Party, and their leader went to France or Germany somewhere very recently, and it had a very large, pretty large audience there. And we know that Turkish nationalist movement, for instance, is pretty strongly organized in among migrant communities in Germany, and as now I increasingly realize, maybe in France too. So I'm wondering, what do you have to say about this phenomenon of long-distance nationalism, this space of new space of, you know, new global space of some sort of nationalism?
Thank you. Very interesting question, actually. The migrant communities, when detached, let's say in a nutshell, in quotes, detached from the national context, there's always this argument that they live in this frozen imaginary of the world, of their homeland. So this image of the frozen image of the homeland, it can constantly adds to this longing for the homeland, and their national identity. I think national identity becomes one of the most important aspects, components of one's identity in a context where one is constantly challenged with or faces the other. In this sense, there was huge concern, particularly in parts of on part of Germany and Britain, in relation to Turkish or broadcasts in Turkish coming to Germany. For example, one of the concerns was that they would that this would create a cultural ghettoization, that this would create the uprise of, not uprise, but the incline in a nationalist tendency. Same in Britain, and actually the same arguments were being made in Australia as well. But many scholars, many researchers today, including myself, are arguing that yes, it does cause a form of nationalism, but if we can call it, it creates kind of a tamed nationalism, if we can call it that, I think, because what it, particularly for the second and third generation migrants, particularly for the younger migrants, I mean, the first generation migrants are really there's really very little that you can do to undo that mystic home thing and the nationalist ideas that are attached to that. But for the second and third generation, it actually de-ethnicizes that or disrupts that nostalgia of the homeland, I think. And the pejorative component of nationalist identity comes from that nostalgia, I think, within the context of the migrant. The way it disrupts it is, let me give an example from Australia, for where my research was conducted previously. The second and third generation young migrants, Turkish migrants, were living with the stories of their grandparents, for example. How Turkey was, how Turkish songs were, because they had no access to simultaneous media coming from Turkey, and they had very limited access to traveling to Turkey. Whenever they started watching satellite television, this happens in 2000, so this is quite a huge gap from the time that they've migrated to Australia, almost 30 years. Whenever they started watching satellite channels, they actually realized there's a Turkey out there that's more compatible to our lives in Australia than the stories of our grandparents, the Turkey in the stories of grandparents. So I think that was creating a disruption on their nostalgia. That was pushing them to become transnational as opposed to diasporic. And I think that distinction influences the national consciousness and nationalistic ideologies of individuals. When you are feeling like a diasporic subject, I think you are more tend to, or one is more tend to feel nationalist or the upsurge of nationalist identity. But when you are more a transnational subject, I think nationalism or nationalist identity becomes one of those resources that you can tap into identify yourself, and not a resource that is much more predominant than, for example, your sexuality or your sexual identity or your age, you know. I think satellite televisions for the second, third, and younger generations actually have a impact that is, I think, positive in terms of disrupting that disruptive nationalist tendencies, I think. Okay, I hope this is.
Thank you. I think I want to thank all the panelists for the presentations. I want to go back to the issue of what is Turkish and how we define as Turkish. But before that, I think the distinction you made between transnational and diasporic, I think, is fundamental, and I haven't heard it made before because it somehow assumed that the diasporic is part of the transnational. But I'm talking about, I have a PhD student who's working on a dissertation about Turkish media consumption in Germany, and one of the most fascinating things she's found out so far is doing some field work in Istanbul this last summer. Is a community of second and third generation Turkish Germans who come back from Germany in the summer and work in Istanbul. So they stay with family, they work in Istanbul. And one of the things that's fascinating is the way they articulate who they are through what they watch. The things that they really enjoy watching are actually the same soap operas that we're talking about yesterday that show upper class Istanbul families doing this and that. And then there are two or three sitcoms produced by in German, but with Turkish themes in Germany that they like a lot. And they really, there are differences between how they don't feel that they're Turks and German. They really argue that they're both Turkish and German. And I think hence the difference between the transnational and the diasporic. I think it's fascinating. The fact that these kids can come and live in Istanbul for 3 months, not feel like strangers, although their grandfather went to Germany from Turkey, is that they're really not just diaspora Turks. I think that's fundamental. Now the notion about what is Turkish, how you define. So if you're watching the Turkish channel in Arabic, obviously Turkish, right? So you can define it through the language, is it in Turkish? But then you get into some trouble. You can define it through the location. You can define, is it in Turkey, is it based in Turkey? You can define it through the audience. Does it target Turks? What if it target Turks in German? Is it Turkish? I think this is very important. And I'm not sure how to resolve it. And I'm not sure we need to resolve it. I'm not sure to be able, that we need, I mean, probably the policymakers would disagree. I think it's fundamental to be able to say, you know, this is Turkish or not, because that perhaps defines jurisdiction, right? Whether you can regulate something or address it. But for academic purposes, for scholarly purposes, do we need to be able to pinpoint this is this nationality and this is not? That's my question to you.
Well, that's a good question. Thank you. Do we need to? My hunch is that if we somehow find. I'm not a fan of categorizing things, but on the other hand, it does help resolve issues better. So if we are able to say that this is Turkish, then we can, or, and this is not, then perhaps we may be able to talk about the ghettoizing effect or de-ghettoizing effect of Turkish quotes, transnational broadcasts on Turks living abroad. So my approach was from here. But, and my argument is, at this point, we can't really say that these broadcasts are Turkish. Or when you look at it from one perspective, we say, yes, they're Turkish. But looking at them from another perspective, then you say, well, they're the generic programs that you see all over the world. Is it just because they're in Turkish? The fact that they're in Turkish, and perhaps more importantly, the fact that they are coming from Turkey is, I think, what makes them more Turkish. I'll just give very briefly an example. When I was in Sydney, there was the Olympics. 2002 or 1, I can't remember at the moment. The Olympics. The Olympics were taking place in Homebush, the suburb Homebush. And Homebush is like 2-3 kilometers away from Auburn, where the Turkish suburb was located in Sydney. About 40,000 Turks, about 35,000 Turks were living there. Now, and Naim Süleymanoğlu and the Halil who's the other guy, the weightlifter, Halil Mutlu was coming, okay, to the Olympics. And what they did was, they did not go 3 kilometers afar and watch the Olympics live, but they opened this huge linen kind of projector in the middle of the suburb. The suburb was a place where cut by two streets, okay? They opened this huge projector and watched it through TRT INT. So there were like thousands of Turks in the square. The suburb square, okay, watching the Olympics, which was taking place 3 kilometers next to them, being beamed back to Turkey, and then from Turkey being beamed back to them. That made them feel that they were watching something Turkish, because it was coming from Turkey. Now, I'm sure, more interestingly perhaps, I'm sure at the same particular time, Turks in Germany watching the same event in their own suburbs or in their own cafes, and Turks in Netherlands were doing the same thing, and in the States. So that's I think very interesting. Creating that, that's what's creating that communality, transnational communality, if we can call that, among Turks. So,
are you saying that basically it's the common mediation of TRTN? Because would they
feel more Australian than Turkish had they gone in person to the Olympics? Yes, I'm not sure. I mean, that's something I need to think about. Would they feel more Australian had they gone there? Probably not, but I'm kind of sure that they felt more Turkish watching it. Okay, it might also be, another thing is they had TRT INT, all of them had TRT INT in their homes, but they chose to watch it in the companionship of their nationals. Okay, so I think that that communality again is something that's adding to that national consciousness and or the homeland national consciousness, if you like. So they didn't go to the Olympics, but they didn't watch the Olympics from home either. You know, they were in the communion of their fellow nationals. So maybe that's the trick. Rather than watching it from TRT Int or from the Olympics, watching it as a Turkish group. I don't know, but that's something. I mean, thank you. I'll think about that. Okay, that's important.
Yüzyılcım.
Gökçen, thank you for this thought-provoking paper, and especially the Olympic Games example was very exciting. And now, as far as I can see, your survey is limited to the television channels broadcasting through satellite. But yes. We very well know that these programs are also uploaded on the internet. Sometimes some of them are live, some of them recorded. Some of them are uploaded by the television channels themselves. Some of them are by some groups, I don't know what. But I mean, did you have any chance to compare the two? I mean, do you know of any significant discrepancy between the two sources of these images?
No. I mean, the short answer is no. Unfortunately, I haven't had a chance to look at the online distribution of these media outlets, but that would be very interesting to look at, actually, because many even 5 years ago, many young Turks in Australia, young Turkish Australians were consuming Turkish media, you know, conventional Turkish media through the internet. So I think that's also, and forums are very, very big things. I mean, in addition to media broadcasting, mass media, forums that are taking place among the diasporic or transnational subjects are places where you can get very valuable and interesting data, I think. But I haven't had a chance to look at them, no.
Okay. Thank you. Arthur, please go ahead.
A comment and a question. I think the festive viewing of the Olympic Games relates a little bit to the genre of media events. Diane and Cass talk about that. That kind of events, just like Eurovision Song Contest, are the things that people come together to watch rather than watching alone. And it creates a different kind of enthusiasm on the part of the audience, especially if it's a contest, such as Olympics or Eurovision Song Contest. Another supportive argument or data from my research about Eurovision was that TRT is broadcasting Eurovision, but at the same time, for instance, for a Turkish communities member in Germany, they can watch Eurovision from their German channels as well. So what happens is most of the Turks do watch through Turkish channel, and during the broadcast, Bülent Özveren, the world famous commentator of the program, says that now we are beginning the voting section. So please switch to your homeland TV channels and get the number from there and vote for Turkish singers. So there you can see the complication. Because if they go on watching and if they vote for Turkish numbers announced on Turkish screen, they won't be able to vote, simply, because they must vote in Germany for Turkish TV. So this is also, I think, a kind of supportive information. Another question is about the Turkishness of a media. When I was working for Swedish public radio Turkish broadcast in Sweden, this was a service only made for Turks living in Sweden. So it was financed by the Swedish public service, and it was a small section, but we were doing mostly news programs for the Turks, about Turks living in Sweden. So it wasn't news from Turkey at all. So it was a community media in that sense. In 2005, Swedish public service decided to finish the broadcast, and their main argument was that Turks living in Sweden have access to Turkish media from Turkey, so they don't need the media that they produce here. And actually, that's a big contradiction, because our main argument was that we are the Swedes living in Turkey and we are doing our own news. Why stop this one and get the news from Turkey? And otherwise, who will get the make the news of the community living in Sweden, but it wasn't a strong argument. And I will relate this to the bigger, I don't want to say simplified things, but actually this is a trend of minimizing the public service in Sweden. So it actually relates to somehow to neoliberalistic understanding of let's leave this to commercial TV channels broadcasting from Turkey. It's not our job. We are public service, and first of all, budget is getting smaller, so we have to choose what is our priority. And when it comes to Turks living in Sweden, that's not our job. Let's leave it to Turks in Turkey. So that was a kind of complicated, or it looks like a contradiction. I don't know what you comment on this, Gökçen, having done your work.
I mean, something similar was debated in Australia as well. I can give you that example. Australia has this public service expansion of its public service broadcasting, which is called SBS, Special Broadcasting Service. And what it does is it broadcasts in minority languages, like 20 of them, I think. So 1 hour of Turkish every week was broadcasted there. And at some point, there was this right-wing conservative government who decided that watching television in their own language, but more importantly, watching television from homeland in their own language, was actually preventing these migrants from consuming Australian media, which was putting them, cutting their tie with the Australian community or society, let's say. This was debated very, very heavily, and in the end they left it alone, they didn't touch it. But as I said, this is an argument that's been going on in Germany as well. This Turkish media coming from Turkey is creating cultural ghettoization. It's stopping the Turkish migrant from consuming German media. I wouldn't agree with that. I mean, I of course it is to a certain extent doing that, but on the other hand, these people are living in Germany anyway. I mean, you turn on the television, watch television, and then you turn off the television, open your door, and you're in Germany. I mean, there's no way that you can stay away from the German life or the German culture or the Swedish culture or the Australian culture, okay? I mean, media is, yes, it's mediating a certain reality, but on the other hand, you're living in that particular society. I don't know. I mean, it's something constantly being debated, I think, but it's I don't have an answer to that, obviously, at this point.
Okay, thank you. Professor Mutman had a question, I think.
Another example is, of course, I mean, all these examples remain to be examples, but Fatih Akın, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I thought, very talented guy, right? I mean, Duvara karşı is an how do they translate it into English? Head on the wall. Okay, Head on the Wall was an extraordinary movie. It was one of the best criticisms of racism I have ever heard, because the word didn't even pass in the movie. That was the best part of it. But I mean, take for instance Crossing the Bridge. Crossing the Bridge was straightforward Orientalism, right? I mean, because a lot of people think Orientalism is, oh, Orientals are poor, backward, stupid people. No, Orientalism is also, we love the Orientals, how lovely they are, look at them, oh, their music is so lovely, I love them. I mean, who comes here, the famous German avant-garde band, I forgot his name, you know, he comes here and he makes a tour in Istanbul, you know, the guy who is telling the story and so on. So it was very typical, right, straightforward Orientalist movie. So even the people who come here from when they come back, they can't speak Turkish, etc., etc. So one possible way of describing those people would be Germans. I mean, right? They are new Germans. I think the situation of migrants, of course, is a very complicated kind of phenomenon, right? Etc., etc. But also, it's inevitably related with the future of Germany.
Definitely, yes. I mean, right? in terms of their identifications, Ayhan Kaya, among others, for example, suggests that we can't identify them as
more this than the future
or
of
this or this or this. as opposed to this and this and this and this. So we need to identify them as with ands as opposed to with ors. So they're not either Turkish or either German, but both Turkish and German, but they're not Turks that live in Turkey, or they're not the same. So they're new Turks, new Germans, different, you know? I mean, that's what Baba talks about when he says.
No, I have huge respect for your opinion, but I'm not saying that. I'm saying they are Germans, they are new Germans, and they are more about the future of Germany or France than about the future of Turkey.
Okay, yes, yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay, thank you.
And, Marwan, you want to follow? Yes.
My question this time is for Mr. Yüce and perhaps Mr. Öztürk also. One of the debates in academic studies of television is whether there is such a thing as television anymore, or whether in the next few years there will be something called television. So television is no longer the box, since you can watch it on the laptop or even on a mobile phone. To what extent do these issues? To what extent have you already confronted these issues in actual policy decisions? Or to what extent do these issues come up? So for instance, if someone in Turkey starts what we might call a television channel, but it's entirely web stream online, who regulates that? What are the overlapping jurisdictions? If I'm watching a Turkish content on my iPhone through the 3G network, do you regulate this? Is it telecom who regulates this? To what extent do you discuss these issues, and to what extent who regulates the convergent media landscape in Turkey?
Of course, we are aware that most people now, especially young people, watch their programs from internet, some from IPTV, but most of the time web TV. So also this is the challenge for a regulator, because we sometimes give license from satellite for satellite programs, for cable programs, for terrestrial programs, but we don't give any license to the web TV programs. We regulated the IPTV. It's a kind of video on demand services, but of course it is more easily regulated by our cable licensing regulation. But of course, when we talk about web TV, it is not very easily controlled. So we see internet environment as a free environment for broadcasting purposes. Of course, there are some general rules, protection of minors, protection of Turkish Turkishness or Atatürk, for example. There are some rules, category rules, and these rules are regulated by ICT regulator. But these rules apply for not web TV broadcast, but also internet web TV, web pages and etc. But of course, if we try to regulate the web environment, then it will be impossible for us to monitor the content, especially, and to give licenses all those programs. And if we, for example, manage to give license from Turkish companies, then there will be opportunity for some companies to go from outside Turkey. So it is, in my personal opinion, it's a better idea to leave the web TV environment free. And of course, there will be some international general rules, as I mentioned. But other than, we will look at to the public and we will see a transition. Of course, when mobile broadband also will be available more and more in the future, LTE type of services. And we will give some frequencies from terrestrial to mobile broadband services in the future, you know, after analog switch off. It's called digital dividend. So, of course, there will be a change, and maybe in the future we will be converged with the ICT regulator in the future, maybe, because industry is merging. But currently, we don't regulate the web TV environment, But we give license for IPTV, and we leave the web TV free.
And web radio also, you don't regulate?
Yeah, we don't regulate currently.
Okay. Nikos Lambers, please. Okay, please.
To give the answer, to complete the answer, actually, the categorized crimes in Turkey, including the internet, on the internet, are subject to the cyber crimes prosecutor office. So they are followed by the Minister of Justice, basically. So, including with the web casting, they are all followed by the Minister of Justice itself. We have a special cyber crime prosecutor office. So it's beyond the authority of the RTÜK. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Landrus.
Yes. Question for Volkanos Turk and Taha Yücel. Sorry for misspelling your names. First of all, thank you very much for a very interesting presentation, as well for as Gopcha and Karanfil. I'm certain that you know that in policy-making circles, as well as in academic circles, there is growing concern about diversity or pluralism in media. And I noticed that you mentioned diversity of content as an issue. In the past, there was a lot of interest in what we call external pluralism, which means concentration of ownership. But in addition to the need for external pluralism, there is a need for internal pluralism, in the sense that you may have many media outlets, but they may broadcast similar content. So you may have diversity or pluralism in ownership, but not so much in content, in the sense that not all cultural groups, religious groups, political groups, or sections in society, geographical places and sections of the population that live in different locations, etc., are adequately represented in the content produced by the media. And indeed, there is a conflict and a difference between American scholars and American authorities and European authorities. American authorities speak about diversity of content in the sense that they think the media is a huge market, and they believe that the consumers need to have choice. So if there are many different types of content, is enough. Europeans, on the other hand, point out that this is not what we want. What we want is a much more, we have to know the different social groups, etc., and all of them must be represented. So diversity is not enough. We need a positive understanding that different opinions, religious, cultural, sexual, etc., are represented. So I would like to ask you about this issue. How do you approach this difficult issue? And if there are any monitoring tools with respect to either pluralism or diversity, and which of these two concepts are closer to your perspective?
First of all, we give licenses without looking at the detail of the program. We don't categorize the programs as this is the main view, this is the minority view, and etc. But normally, they broadcasters apply to Supreme Council for license, and they give some technical and some organizational information. Of course, we look at to the group ownership, and we control the monopolization. But after the licensing, they are free to broadcast their programs. And when we look at to the broadcast environment in Turkey, especially satellite is the dominated area, we can say that every view in Turkey, sometimes is disturbing, can have access to its audience, and we have a very diversified environment. But of course, some of the channels are not watched by a large audience. But we make broadcasting industry to ensure that if somebody wants to access a program, news, and etc., and it has a certain type of cultural background or certain kind of political view, then it is possible for him to access its channel. For example, there is a channel broadcasting all the time some Kurdish programs. There is a channel continuously talking about one of the minority parties, and etc. So there are many broadcasters. When with these broadcasters, we have many views which are broadcast. Of course, there are some rules, content rules, and they shouldn't accuse innocent people, they shouldn't harm the children, etc. But if they don't avoid those rules, then we don't give any sanctions.
If I can insist on that, the real problem is, okay, there is access. But and there is a need to for different viewpoints to be expressed. But what happens if this is not happening in practice? Because, for instance, you might have a small minority group, but broadcasters think that this group is not important commercially, for instance. Okay. Mm-hmm. So in theory there is access, but in practice this mm-hmm. is not represented. I understand that you cannot force anyone. My question is there any monitoring tool that would say, that would give you an idea mm-hmm. if pluralism or diversity exists in practice or not? Because, okay, you may have the principle, but in practice, many views, cultural views, political views, religious views, do not find it easy mm-hmm. to express themselves through the main channels. Is there any monitoring tool that gives you an idea of what is happening in practice?
Currently, we don't have a monitoring tool to monitor this kind of views. But of course, we don't have any application for this issue also. I don't remember that we have a community coming to us and saying that we need a channel, but we don't have a television or radio channel broadcasting our views and etc. But we don't have a monitoring tool for these purposes.
Geçim Kaptan.
I have a question for Volkan Yücel and Taha Volkan Öztürk and Taha Yücel. While you are, you know, explaining what the new law brought, you mentioned that freedom of expression and dissemination of information are ensued.
Yeah.
Could you please specify more on that, and where does the line stand for Rütük between freedom of expression and punishment for expression?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Of course, this is a general rule, you know. You can express your view, but you cannot, for example, accuse an innocent people expressing a view in the television program. Sometimes we give penalties for these kind of programs. Then a discussion, they talk about another person, or they talk among themselves, and they accuse an innocent people for wrong purposes, or when, for example, there is a case in the court, they talk about the court case and they accuse people, but they didn't, the court didn't give the decision. So then, of course, our red line comes into effect, and we give some notice and etc. And sometimes, while they are expressing their views, they harm children. For example, we have some women programs, which I call, and they sometimes have guests which are not adult, which are not very well organized, but they talk about some other children, or they have children guests and etc. When they give their views, they sometimes harm the children in these discussions. But generally, other than those kind of issues, we don't. We are tolerating the arguments normally.
Well, I think the conceptualization of your question is questionable, because there can never be punishment for the freedom of expression or for the expression of a certain view. By definition, it is the case, and legally it is the case in Turkey. And when it comes to the broadcasting issues, the freedom of expression should be made in a fashion that doesn't violate another human rights, like the protection of privacy, like many other relevant broadcasting standards. For example, as my colleague mentioned, when you use your freedom of expression by explaining certain opinions on an issue, you shouldn't insult anybody. You shouldn't incite any terror or any other act of
violence.
So as long as you are expressing your views in a given framework, which is described in the law, which is defined in our broadcasting standards, there can never be punishment. So you should know how to use your freedom of expression, in short. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all very much. I actually have a question to Mr. Yücel. Now, he's not only a member of the board, but also the vice president of the board, as far as I know, right? And before that, he's been working at RTÜK for how many years? I don't know. I mean, he was
a technical expert in between 1994.
So he's been there for a long time. So he knows what has been going on in RTÜK for many, many years, and what RTÜK has been doing, etc. So, and you showed us some very interesting graphs about the growth of Turkish media, and where we are heading, actually, is that's going to be my question. How do you see it in, let's say, 5-10 years? Because now we have two digital platforms, two cable platforms, as you said. And of course, the internet is playing a big role with the IPTV. Yeah. Now, IPTV is becoming much more popular than we could ever imagine in, let's say 5 years ago. And the advertising revenue is, of course, the engine for this sector, and it's been growing. So I'm sure you have some projections and ideas about where we will be heading, and what RTÜK is going to be doing in the next era, let's say.
Of course, when we look at the history, we see that ad revenues are developing very fast, and they are, and the growth of ad revenue is sometimes twofold of Turkish general economic growth. So I think it will continue for a while like this, because there are some new Turkish brands, there are some new Anatolian companies are coming into the market, and they need television and radio programs to make their brands available to all the public. So This growth will continue, I think. And when we compare the ad revenue per capita, we have still have a good potential when we compare it with the European Union countries, because it is still low when we look at per capita. But of course, pay TV business also will be developing, and in global research, we see that pay TV revenues of broadcast industry is developing more than ad revenues. And in some countries, ad revenue growth stopped, and pay TV business is expanding. This is the reason people want to access programs anytime, anywhere, any content. So also we'll see this kind of revenues in Turkey. But IPTV business was not penetrated much. They had a good launch, they have a very good business plan, but they have only around 30,000 subscribers. They have some problems. The broadband capacity is not very enough. In most of the houses, it's not very enough to distribute, especially HDTV programs. When we allocate the frequencies in terrestrial, we will see a growth in HDTV broadcasters, and it will also affect the ad revenues in a good way. But of course, when we project 10 years window, then of course, depending on the broadband technology, development of the broadband technology, the ad revenues will saturate, and they will start going down, and of course the revenues of subscribers, subscriptions, and etc., video on demand revenues will increase. So if a broadcaster make a long-term business plan, then they should consider producing interesting programs, producing their own programs. And if a broadcaster only collects programs from the international, national producers, and if they broadcast them by using a schedule, then this business plan will not be very easily survive.
Thank you very much. And I think this brings us to the end of our two-day colloquium, and we will be wrapping up now. And thank you all very much for being here, and to all the participants who talked for since yesterday, and who came here and contributed with the discussion and asked questions. It's been a very nice colloquium, and of course we must thank Gökçen and İletişim for their incredible work. I personally know that they are very tired, and I was kind of ashamed when I saw them, because I felt like I'm doing nothing. And you know, when I saw the things they were dealing with and in putting this organization into life. And of course, on behalf of the school, if my dean allows me, I would like to thank Rütük for sponsoring and organizing this colloquium in association with the faculty. Thank you all very much for being here.